first of all, to introduce steampunk and so we can talk about it and all the different things that it encompasses as a genre.
Okay.
I've been active in the steampunk community for about 4 years. That's how I got into costuming. I have a blog and I talk about steampunk all the time. And I've gone to lots of events to represent steampunk. And the other thing is because I find it very interesting because I'm interested in historical costuming and that sort of aspect. There's very different approaches in the steampunk community versus historical costuming, in attitude, in approaches, and in sort of finished products. So I'm just sort of interested in the different ways of going about it. And the other reason is because I've occasionally seen people who are established costumers make steampunk outfits. And I've seen incredible costumes. But I've also seen people who are like, okay, this is my steampunk outfit. And it's a beautiful, historically accurate bustle dress, and they have one accessory that's steampunk. I even saw somebody who did, this is my historically accurate bustle dress, but the trim isn't period appropriate. It's some steampunk. And so I just think that there's more that can be done.
No.
And there's a lot of different things that you can do to make something steampunk. And this is also totally a conversation, so feel free to offer suggestions and ideas or things that you've done, you know, as we go. First of all, what is steampunk? Most common question that anybody answers.
We get passed every time we go through.
Yeah, like at lunch.
Twice.
Basically, the general definition, of course, is Victorian science fiction. And that's pretty broad, but that opens up a lot of possibilities. And it's very much open up to personal interpretation.
Mm-hmm. In our neck of the woods, the Bay Area, it's Victorian to Edwardian.
Yes, I'm going to talk about that.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of different types of steampunk. There's subgenres within the steampunk community, within the steampunk style. And there's almost new ones being created all the time, which is cool. But some of the big subgenres, there's steampunk itself. There's neo-Victorianism, which is very Victorian, of course. There's diesel punk, which is based around the time period of World War I, World War II. So it's a science fiction sort of version that includes those fashions. It could be, you know, World War I, where we've got, you know, military spats and this sort of style, all the way up to 1940s fashions. And some people take parts from that and parts from the Victorian era and mix it all together, and it's whatever you want. And it's fine.
And those are time travelers.
Yes, and that's, you know, I just tell people, look, the time machine on my airship, it gets all screwed up, and, you know, especially when I'm at Ren Fairs and people start harassing me. clock punk is a term that's used for pre-industrial age steampunk, Renaissance, when the technology was mostly clock, or the highest level of technology was clockwork based. I've also heard the term Renpunk as just sort of Renaissance slash steampunk combination. There's a fairly new genre, Rococo punk, which is cool because it tends to be very pastel, bright colors, obviously 18th century, with the attitude of steampunk. That, you know, that has that punk rock attitude that breaks rules and everything. I think that's just cool.
You see a lot of that in the Japanese punk scene.
Yeah.
Rock scene.
Well, yeah, and you get sort of into Lolita, and right. There's so many genres of fashion that end up blending. Western punk, you see this very often, Western elements in steampunk, especially here in Texas.
No.
You know.
California.
Yeah, I mean, obviously in the West, we tend to have more of that attitude. Some people just have one piece.
And it's kind of an offshoot of just remembering that, you know, Victorian times.
The old West was the Victorian
period.
It didn't just happen in England. It was happening here. We didn't have a queen, but same thing. And then also a big one is post-apocalyptic steampunk, which may not include any Victorian elements at all. And, you know, it's very sort of road warrior, lots of leather, lots of armor, lots of metal, but it's, and people have different interpretations, but it's basically like a post, you know, the oil industry has collapsed and we're relying, it's on steam and steam technology in a post-apocalyptic situation. And people are, you know, cobbling together all these gadgets from whatever they can find. Which can be very, very different from someone who's been a Victorian. So because it's a broad genre, it covers lots of bases. Some differences in between steampunk and historical costuming. First of all, steampunks don't particularly care about historical accuracy. You know, we might appreciate it, but you know, how a garment is put together. Nobody cares. What the material is, nobody really cares. You know, a lot of people are like, hey, I made this from a sheet from Walmart. And that's awesome, you know. It doesn't have to be silk that, you know, was made 200 years ago or whatever. And the same topic from my own friend.
I wonder what was in there.
That's not pill popping.
Nobody cares if you have right knickers on.
The right
knickers.
Yeah, or if, you know, one part of your outfit is 1870s and another is 1880s or something like that. You know, and one that's more controversial is that, you know, it doesn't really matter what your items are made of. You know, some people are like, this was a Coke bottle, and I got it out of my trash, and now I've painted it, and it looks like metal, and or this is a Nerf gun. There are some people who are a little bit more elitist about it and say, you know, no, I only use wood and brass, and, you know, I machine all my stuff myself. And that's cool. I mean, I'm really impressed by that. But it doesn't have to be. A lot of people use what you have and reuse things. You know? So it's supposed to look cool, and hopefully the finished item looks like something that's, you know, elaborate and fancy, but it doesn't really matter how it began.
We know a guy with this really nice, awesome-looking eye headpiece, and it looks really cool.
Yeah.
And it's toilet paper tubes. I'm not kidding. And you look at it, you don't see it. You can't necessarily tell what the original parts are.
Yeah.
But yeah, he's like, no, this is just toilet paper tubes.
Like, I literally got this stuff out of my trash and painted it, you know?
And that's okay, you know? It still looks badass.
This is cool. Sorry, I don't really
know. That seems to be the common steampunk attitude in that if it looks okay or if it looks good, it's good.
Yeah.
Style over substance.
The other big difference, yes.
I went to Dickens on the Strand,
uh-huh.
And they do a lot of steampunk
mm-hmm.
there.
Really?
And I was dressed up for the Victorian part of it, and I had on a Scottish plaid, black and white, and red for Christmas sweater. Anyway, I wandered into the steampunk thing, and I was getting all kinds of comments because I was in black. But is there a problem with being in
really?
Black?
No.
There's a cliche that steampunks only wear brown.
Yeah.
Oh, that's such cool.
Or that it's goths that discovered.
Yeah, goths.
Yeah.
It's goths that discover brown. And some people, I guess, look down on wearing black because it looks too much like goth. If you're wearing, you know, Victorian style things in black, I wear a lot of black and purple because black and purple are my colors.
Who's not going to wear black?
Black is everything. You'll see my outfit tonight is like black. So I've never really gotten that, so that's kind of surprising.
Well, that's the first time I've ever wandered into that part of it because I kind of scare me.
It's really not scary. We just tend to be loud. and a little drunk.
A little drunk.
We're nice people.
One of the things that we're trying to do in the Bay Area is we're trying to get people to wear color in steampunk.
Yes, and I'm big into trying to bring color into steampunk. I you know, bring your blues and your greens and your purples because the brown is so cliched, and there's nothing wrong with it. Obviously, I'm wearing brown, but I'm also wearing black, and I've also got all this.
Historically, when Alan dies came in, you had...
Right, the Victorian period was very brightly colored because dyes were available.
Yes. Yeah, bright, I mean, cozy, you could see it 50 and 100 pieces away. Pieces away. You had not only lavender, you also had red, you had orange, you had apple green, you had lime green, you had plaid.
So, and that's the kind of thing that I think like the historical costuming community can really do in steampunk and bring in is that kind of knowledge about, you know, the colors that were actually used and do things that aren't just, you know, the stereotypical steampunk look. I like the blending of that. But one of the things about steampunk is that usually, almost always, if you're steampunk and you're in costume, you're in character. You have, you may not act your character, you may not be like role-playing, but you have a character and your costume is tied to who your character is. As opposed to just being, this is my outfit with a bustle skirt, it's, this is, you know, the Baroness's seamstress's outfit. You know, I've got my sewing tools and my knitting tools on me. I've got my scissors, you know, because I'm a seamstress. I've got, there's a lot of stuff tied into the patches. This is my casual working outfit as the Baroness. I have formal outfits as the Baroness. I have a fancy dress outfit that the Baroness would wear to a fancy dress ball. But the costume informs the character, and your character determines what you're wearing. So there's stories behind why you're wearing the things that you're wearing. You know, which is part of the fun of it, is coming up with justifications for why, you know, why you're wearing certain things. And also when you find something really cool, you're like, oh, okay, so why do I have that? And that informs who you are as a character and the story that you come up with about yourself. And some people take it very seriously and have very elaborate stories and they write it down and they may be completely in character all the time and they may, you know, they're role playing and they're in character. Other people like me don't, you know. I do have a character, I have a backstory, but mostly I'm just me. But it still all goes into when I'm coming up with my costumes and when I'm putting things together. That all that thought is into it. And that's how, I mean, I came up with my own character as I found pieces in thrift stores and as I put my first costume together, it started to be like, well, she's wearing a black skirt because she's a widow. You know, and that, and the pieces that I found helped me, you know, to form the character in the first place. And tied into that is that mostly steampunk costumes are never done. Because they're not just, okay, I'm going to wear a costume, I'm going to wear it for this event, and that's it. It's, this is my clothing that I wear when I'm in steampunk. You know, I'm going to wear it like I wear clothing. And I'm going to constantly add new things to it, or change things up, or I keep this part and upgrade the other part, you know, as I get better at doing stuff or whatever.
And that's something I see a lot more steampunks doing than other cosplayers, is wearing your clothes, wearing your steampunk clothes somewhere, house or around, or at home, or with your friends, or... You know,
to a wedding.
We're going to have game night, and we're all going to dress up, you know? And
or just, yeah, making up excuses. We're going to go to the movies. We're going to go see something.
Well, that's what this guild is all about.
Right. I know you guys do that too, because you need excuses to wear your stuff. Because you put some work into it. But yeah.
And I think doing that helps you connect with the character that you may or may not be portraying.
And that's how, and also why the costume keeps evolving. You're like, okay, I need to do something different about this piece, you know, because I don't like it. Instead of just saying, okay, that costume is done, I'm going to start a new one. You tend to, I mean, I have 4 or 5 outfits at this point. I've got a couple more planned, but, you know, at least a couple of them are ones I've had pieces of since I first started in the steampunk, and I've upgraded and added, swapped out. So I have a gray and black outfit that I've had since the very first year I was doing steampunk. And at first it was a bed sheet made into a skirt and, you know, a bought corset. And then I started making corsets. So I made a corset that goes with that outfit. Then I made a fancier skirt, you know, because I was better at sewing. So it's the kind of thing where people tend to just sort of, outfits get more and more elaborate. And people always ask, well, how much did all that cost? Or
how long
did that take to make? And you're like, I don't know, I've been working on it for 4 years. It was spread out. We talked about repurposing items. Steampunks are big into reusing and repurposing. Like we were talking about building things out of trash, but going to thrift stores, going to yard sales, estate sales, taking old pieces and sprucing them up, adding new details to them.
Taking them apart.
Yeah, taking them apart for parts.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of that's sort of a central part of steampunk. Instead of just I'm going to buy my materials new, it's what can I do with what I have or what I can find.
What can I do with this
cheap like
box
pieces
of tubes that I found at a yard sale and a piece of aluminum that has a cool cutout to it,
And then you become pack rat and
some
junk.
Not that we were doing it.
No, we have no idea what that's about. So, and then I was going to talk about a little bit, how do you make a Victorian outfit? How do you take a Victorian costume and make a steampunk? What would make something steampunk instead of Victorian? And what are things you could add to it? What is materials? What materials it's made out of? And not meaning you used polyester instead of silk or something. But leather is a big ingredient in steampunk. Darth Maul. It just looks cool. He's got a coat that came from a thrift store, and we put leather on the lapels and the cuffs and on the pockets
trim.
And put leather on all the trim, which makes it gives it a real steampunk look.
It was just a raincoat, just a nice, like London fog raincoat or something.
Yeah, but it now looks much more like a flight coat kind of thing. Metal bits, brass, copper, anything metal, chains. Obviously, I've been gears. I'm big into decorative gears. I don't have a problem with decorative gears, okay? Some people will say, you glued the gear on that, and blah, 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 that's cliche.
I
think gears are pretty.
Cool.
Where is it? It's a gear on my little skirt hike, and that's a real cock gear that I dug out of the box. And I just think they look cool, and they're shiny and pretty. Some people make wonderful things that are functional, and that's great. I don't have those skills. Like I said, I'm a big fan of chains. I have a lot of chains on my belt. We were talking about like the time traveling thing of mixing time periods, and it can be within the Victorian period. Maybe you've got a skirt and a bustle. You can blend whatever elements of different fashion periods that you want. World War I spats, with a bustle dress or anything. As long as you can have a justification for it in your head of why you have that, you can have whatever you want.
You don't necessarily have to explain it.
No,
you don't.
I just thought someone's going to walk up to you and say, why do you have that?
Yeah, why are you wearing a fedora? That's not period appropriate. That's not steampunk. Why do you care? This is the thing. That's the other half of the word is punk. Steampunk. I like it. That's what I want to wear. That's what I think looks good. Why am I wearing it? Why do you care?
I'm interested in using 18th century pieces, with Victorian pieces and doing that kind of rule breaking, which is part of that punk attitude, of I like it. I think it looks cool, so I'm gonna do it. And that's funny because we were talking about like people reacting to your outfits and there were some back downstairs. There was like, what is that? Well, it looks really cool. That's pretty much it.
A lot.
Huh?
Neat.
That's neat. Yeah. Taking historical fashions and making them more practical. So making the dresses shorter, easier to move around in, using bloomers, you know, just making things more practical, because in a sort of steampunk world, people are more active. You know, you're on an airship, you're an explorer, you know, people are, you're an inventor. You know, so it's taking the style and the you know, the sort of the essence of the style, but making it wearable and practical in a way that it's actually clothing. It's something that you could actually do things in. You know, mixing women wearing men's clothing, wearing, you know, elements of men's clothing, or vice versa, if you want. Also, mixing cultures, using elements from other cultures, you know, in a respectful way, but incorporating not just being England in the Victorian period, but having, you know, elements of Asian fashion, you know, because
picked up on a trip.
Yeah, in the same spirit of time traveling. You know, if you're in an airship and you're traveling. I got this, you know, in India.
You're going to stop in 60.
In the late 1800s, you had Japan and England having trade, and there was a Japonica period where in England you wore silk from Japan.
Right.
And in Japan, they adopted Victorian
dresses. Yeah, there's some very amazing illustrations of
like
Victorian style dresses in kimono prints, and they're gorgeous.
Japanese,
kind of thing that existed.
The Japanese used the fabrics that they had available to them, but did the Victorian lines. So you can.
And vice versa, it also happened in the West of using, you know, Japanese fabrics or. Incorporating, you know, kimono style, you know, items into clothing. So,
but Japonica was very big in the late 1800s.
Underwear on the outside, big one. Of course, it's on the outside. Obviously, it's a big steampunk thing. But also, you know, bloomers, or just being, you know, I like the look of just this is my underwear. I'm in a chemise and corset and bloomers. You know,
but not your tiny boy.
No. There's a lot. Weapons. Steampunks usually have weapons. That's a big, I don't have my gun on today. But that's a big element of steampunk fashion. We almost always have guns that are all tricked out. And a lot of them are Nerf guns that are painted. That's sort of how everybody starts. Yeah, or water guns. I had one that was a $1 water gun that I painted.
You modify it, stick some springs.
Yeah, you can glue lots of metal stuff to it. Other people make ones from wood and brass candlesticks and lamps. I have a cool one I made from a lamp from a thrift store. So that's, you know, when you really get into more making those kind of things, it's really fun.
You don't have to be particularly good at.
No, I'm like, honey, you drill a hole in this? You know? I mean, I can use the power tools. But these are the kind of things you learn during steampunk. Like learning leatherworking. It's not particularly like high skill leatherworking, but I found a tutorial for making an arm bracer that was really good. So I did that, and then I just riveted a bunch of little pieces of metal, and I have all my knitting tools. So there's always, that's one of the cool things about steampunk is you learn so many different skills and you can incorporate so many things.
Jack of all trades.
Like, you know, prop painting and leatherworking and metalworking. Military styles are big, you know, whether it's actual like military style uniform clothing, adding lots of braid and gimp.
Goggles.
Metals. We're big into metals.
Champagne ribbons.
He's got a coat that's just got all kinds of metals on it, which you can make.
I've really thought about just getting a coat and just covering it.
Where you're taking it.
Yeah.
It'll weigh 150 pounds. You look cool.
But I won't care. Let
me tell you how much this corset weighs. It's incredibly heavy because of these things, which I got at Tandy Leather. They're so heavy. The other thing I was, you know, a lot of a lot of historical costuming, we always go for the really high class aristocratic outfits because they're really pretty. And I understand that, like I said, my character is a baroness for a reason because I like wearing these style of clothes. But there's a lot more that you can do with steampunk. There's a lot of different kinds of characters besides just an aristocrat. Like I mentioned, you know, an explorer, safari style clothing, kids' helmets, you know, khaki. I've seen a whole bustle dress done in khaki. It was really cool with steampunk, you know, accoutrements and everything. Airship pirate is very common because that's just, it's a good excuse. Like I said, it's a good excuse for I travel in an airship, but I have a time travel.
That's why I need a gas mask.
It's why I have goggles. Yeah. It's a very common one. You know, I'm a baroness who stole a prototype airship that my late husband was building. It's part of the thing.
I'm so sorry that you
passed. He's not my husband in steampunk. He's my navigator.
Which is really funny because I never know where I'm going.
Yeah. He's constantly getting lost.
Always.
Obviously a military character. I've seen some really cool monster hunter costumes, vampire killers, zombie killers.
Butterfly slayers.
Mechanics. People, you know, you can do steampunk with a pair of overalls or coveralls, some goggles.
Rusty old wrenches.
Some rusty, you know, some old tools and stuff like that. And you have a steampunk outfit, you know, you got out of your garage. Mad scientist creation. Android. Robot, automaton, there's some really cool, especially makeup looks for that. You know, people who have like clockwork outfits and winding keys at the back and things like that. Low class characters, you know, I've seen a steampunk janitor, chimney sweep.
It was amazing.
Yeah.
It was so amazing.
Yeah.
And it wasn't anything complicated. It wasn't like this person had, you know, like, this awesome chimney brush, you know, it's like, you're a chimney. It was just like one of those things where, like, you just look at them and you knew exactly what they were going for. They just, you know, and it was simple, and it was direct.
And fairly cheap.
Yeah.
But and something you haven't seen before.
Right.
You know? Entertainers, you know, circus people and ladies of the night.
Way over there.
Yeah, well.
But easy.
What are you gonna do?
anybody think of any others? Any other kind of steampunk characters that I didn't mention?
My husband is he wears his SAS outfit and puts some goggles on it, and he has a gun strapped on the outside, and he calls himself a Pinkerton.
Excellent.
That's great.
Excellent.
That's great.
Yeah. Yeah, detective. Pinkerton.
Uh-huh.
I've seen a Bobby, you know, outfit. Mm-hmm.
And he wears a derby.
Yeah.
I just remembered something I saw. It was really cute. They were dressed as steampunk Girl Scouts.
That's great. Yeah. I mean, that's the kind of thing where it's like, oh, I saw a bellhop. You know, like a hotel bellhop. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, people, there's an endless field of creativity, you know, to draw from, which is the cool part.
The Nerf punks.
Nerf punks, yeah. Which is
they took their Nerf guns, and instead of painting their Nerf guns to look steampunk, they did their steampunk outfits in those bright, crazy.
So they have, you know, the corsets and muscles and the steampunk outfits, but they're bright blue and yellow and green, and they match the Nerf guns. It's so cool.
Yeah.
And to say it doesn't have to be brown, you know, why does it all have
to be always brown?
Looking the same. Okay, so I mentioned a little bit, like, what, and that's the kind of, we were talking about, like, the bellhops and Girl Scouts. Those kinds of details can be inspired from so many historical sources. You know, the kind of things, like, the costume I'm going to wear tonight is steampunk Cleopatra that I got from a real fancy dress costume that I saw a photograph of from 1875, Lady Paget, who wore a Cleopatra costume. That's a fancy dress costume, and I just said, oh, that's just, it's awesome because it's Egyptian and it's Victorian, and I can make it steampunk. So those are the kinds of, you know, when you have the historical knowledge already, when you have the costuming knowledge, then you can just make really cool things. I'd also like to see a lot more, like I said, I like things obviously that aren't the most cliche steampunk thing, but instead of, you know, so many things are like the bustle period, you know, I'd like to see more 1840s and 1850s steampunk outfits, you know, as ways to incorporate different historical elements in steampunk. So anybody else have thoughts or questions or ideas?
I was going to say, one of the reasons I think that men are drawn to it is you get to make gadgets.
Yeah, and that's one of the cool things. As opposed to a lot of costuming that is, you know, very female-centric, there's a lot of men who are into steampunk.
Mm-hmm.
Because it has the gadgets, it has guns, it has, you know, military stuff, and it's just...
what guys consider to be cool.
Guys
what
think
guys, it's like...
Yeah. But there's also a lot of men who, you know, sew
right.
and make their own clothes, and they've learned these things because they got interested in it in the first place.
Oh, God, Steve made the steampunk segue.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Very cool.
Very cool.
I know, I'm just like, I'm so jealous of that thing.
I was going to say, one of the things I learned about a long, long time ago, whenever I went to college, we did costume history. One of the things that I do love about steampunk is you can actually see what you are in society or your social status by either how you're dressed or what kind of job that you did. Kind of like with the chimney sweep,
yeah.
You automatically know exactly what it is because of social status or whatever it is, the guy or what they're dressed as. And that's
yeah.
one thing I know about that it is about creating as an actor or a character that you have. A lot of times, what you're dressed as or states exactly what kind of character you're trying to state.
Yeah, and that's sort of like, I like to think of that as a goal of steampunk costume, is that someone should be able to look at what you're wearing and tell who your character is, you know, or at least generally, that's sort of the goal. If you look, okay, I've got, you know, fabric shears, and I've got needles and a thimble, and I've got, you know, stitch or dye patches, and I've got this stuff that if you look at me, you can say this is a seamstress, you know. Or, you know, this person is upper class, this person is a janitor, you know, this person is on an airship or is a pilot, you know. And I think that's one of the cool things, you know, in steampunk.
But it's also one of the hard things, because you have to, I mean, for like people who are just wanting to start, are like,
yeah,
but it's all been done, what do I choose?
And that's where I said, you know, that things tend to come really organically, I think. I think you sort of start off with, okay, I've got a vest and a shirt and
right.
a skirt.
And you're supposed to see where it goes.
And then as you find pieces or you make pieces or you get an idea, you keep adding to it, and that's how your character sort of comes about.
Yeah.
The other thing is that a lot of steampunk seems to be thrift store buys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You don't.
There are lots of people who don't sew at all.
Yeah, there's a great portion that don't sew or do minimal sewing, but they can find stuff in a thrift store and do something like add an embellishment or fabric paint or something like that to make it theirs.
Yeah. I mean, first outfits we made, most of the stuff was hot glued onto his coat.
Yep.
And because I didn't sew, and I cut a dress down, I cut it at the waist and folded it over and hand sewed, because I'd never used a sewing machine before in my life. And that's how we started out. But a lot of steampunks learn these skills. Either sewing or leatherworking or jewelry making or whatever it is.
And you'll see a lot of swapping.
And there's a lot of information sharing and
right.
knowledge sharing, which is another thing I really like about.
Mm-hmm.
Or a lot of, you know, hey, I'll make you a leather bracer if you will
sew me a vest
or something.
Sure. Yeah. So that's all kind of built into the attitude as well.
Does DFW area have a steampunk event coming up?
Oh!
Sharon?
Yes.
What?
Thursday, SIS, Steampunk Illumination Society. They're doing this, I think, throughout the entire summer. They're having poetry slams at half price books. It'll be this, it'll be on the 3rd, and I believe it starts at 8 p.m. And the theme for this one is Wild West, although I already have my costume when it was Oriental. and then they changed the theme. So Rada and I are still going to go, you know. But SIS has got a really good website.
Yeah, Steampunk Illumination Society is here in Dallas, and they do a lot of events and meetups and stuff like that. So you should get on their mailing list.
Yeah, Dallas is some really good stuff.
The Sea Dog Slam is not, SIS isn't the presenters of it. They are supporters of it.
Right.
The Sea Dog Slam is the Sea Dog Slam.
Right. I'm not in Dallas. Central Texas, so I know of things, but I've not intimately.
Yeah, last month was the pirate, steampunk pirate poetry slam. That was really good.
There is, in September there's going to be a steampunk event in Dallas. The,
yes.
Oh, I'm blanking on what it's called.
Skyborn.
Yeah, it's going to be a concert 2 days.
Yes,
like 10 bands. There's just some really great bands playing. That's like, I think it's September
21st.
20th. Yeah, it's right in there. Carnival Menagerie. I'm going to be bending. That should be really good. Like I said, there's going to be some really good bands playing.
Yeah.
That one. And everybody should be in their best dressed gear.
It's not local, but in August in New Orleans.
What, the 3rd? August 3rd.
There's a big
steampunk. And there's a lot of little events and stuff. And we go to Ren Fairs and have Steampunk Day and stuff like that.
Dickens on the Strand.
Yeah.
One of the things that you can do is if you go to the International Costumers Guild webpage, there is a events listing, convention listing of a whole bunch of things, and steampunk is in there as well. And you can find stuff just about anywhere.
Mm-hmm. And there's been a lot of, we've had several steampunk conventions in Texas. There's just none coming up right now, but for next year there'll be some.
Well, your anime conventions tend to be real good steampunk draws.
Yeah, we just had Comic Clues.
There's a big steampunk track there. Yeah.
There's a lot of crossover. A lot of anime is steampunk.
Yeah, there's some anime steampunk. So they tend to be pretty friendly to steampunk at all the anime conventions. Yeah. We just look for excuses to dress up.
Also do anime cosplays.
Yeah, and there's a lot of crossovers too. Mm-hmm.
But there's also a lot of steampunk groups on Facebook.
Yeah.
That are here for Dallas, just Texas in general, that you can find.
Well, you can find steampunk groups on Facebook just about anywhere.
There's a lot on Facebook, but there's ones for this area. if I have a blog, Steam and Genius, which was on if you got the course that came out this morning, and I've got links to stuff on there as well. I just didn't bring any handouts.
In cards.
I don't know.